Okay, so before I start, can I have a quick survey? How many structural engineers are present?
Yeah.
Okay, very good number. So now I will ask another question. How many of you have practical difficulties by adopting Section 12 of, say, ISO 2007? Okay, so many of you have practical difficulties, correct? Okay, first let us understand why I have chosen this topic. In 2008, when we have started designing the first structure with the limited design method, when this new code was introduced, which is ISO 2007, at that time, my senior came and told me that, "Bhavin, can you please explore that there is a section 12, it may be for the earthquake resistant design of structures." And I have started exploring it since 2008. And let me tell you honestly, till today I am exploring it. Because I am receiving so many queries from my colleagues. Queries like whether section 12 is applicable for my structure under consideration. Second question, if section 12 is applicable, then certain clauses of section 12 are applicable to this structure or not? And if these clauses are applicable, then how to interpret these clauses? And then I'm giving my own answers to them. So then I thought that I think it may be the appropriate platform where I can share that knowledge. So whatever I'm going to share now, it is just my own understanding. You also, you can have different understanding on this topic. And I would be glad to receive your feedback maybe through this WhatsApp number, what is there on your table. So what we are going to cover quickly in this coming next 20 minutes, that what is section 12 is all about. We'll talk a little bit about Northridge earthquake and steel structures. And we'll try to understand overall philosophy of the section 12. We'll have a quick journey of section 12 thereafter. And then finally, I will make certain concluding remarks from my experience. Okay. So we all know that ISO 2007 was released in 2007, and it is a limited design based code. It is having 17 sections and 8 annexures. And if we see very quickly the areas covered in ISO 2007, it starts from material methods of analysis, limited design methods. Here there is an option for working stress design method. Connection design is included. There is a section for earthquake resistant design, which we are going to discuss in the next slide. There are sections for the fatigue testing, durability, fire resistance, as well as the fabrication and direction. So our focus is on section 12. And section 12, as we have just spoken a little bit in the before couple of minutes, it is for the earthquake resistant design. Now, whenever we talk about earthquake engineering, I always talk in three verticals, which is design, detailing, and execution. That means we have to take care of all these three verticals equally. Also, when we talk about section 12, the interface with the other Indian standard code is also very important. Since it is related to earthquake resistant design of structures, IS 1893 part 4, which is particularly for the industrial structures, it was released in 2015. And part 4 2015, it talks about plastic design for the steel structure. It also talks about verification of collapse mechanism. That means non-linear time history analysis needs to be carried out. We will see a little bit in more detail in the coming slides. But this is also very much important area, that is the interface between two different Indian standard codes. Now, when we talk about limit state design method, this is not a conventional revision of the Indian standard code, and also we do not have the detailed handbook along with the practical examples. So there are certain practical difficulties with the practicing engineers whenever they are designing the structure. So those kind of questions, in my opinion, can be answered through the philosophical angle of the code. That means we need to understand, first of all, overall philosophy of the code. So let's talk about little bit about the North Ridge earthquake and the and scale structures. The North Ridge earthquake happened in 1994 in USA. And as we were discussing in the previous sessions also, a couple of speakers have highlighted this point, that steel structures are more safe when we talk about the earthquake resistant design, because it is a ductile material. But this thought process was challenged in North Ridge earthquake in 1994, which happened on 17 January. What happened? There were many brittle fractures in the beam column junctions. Majority in the moment resisting frame structures. So let us try to understand what went wrong. If we take a quick survey, the height of the structures were varying from the 1 story to the 26 story. And also age of the structure varying from the 30 years to the almost they were erected at the time of the earthquake. It is also important to note that there was no catastrophic damage which happened in the 1994 earthquake event. But the welded connection of almost 90 buildings were damaged, and there were brittle fractures. So, as a design philosophy, the expected damage was maybe moderate yielding or maybe local buckling, but it was not expected that the brittle fracture will happen in the structures. So, here now what we see on the screen is the typical detail which was adopted before 1994 earthquake. And all fractures were triggered from the wind, from the welding, which has been highlighted in the figure. So it was proven after this earthquake that if welding is done inadequately or say inappropriately, then this can become the weak link in the structure. Now, in order to determine that whether structure has undergone damage in terms of connection, it is very tedious and very costly process, because we have to remove all architectural finishes including fireproofing just to cross check whether connection has undergone damage or not. And even after finding out that whether connection has undergone damage, the process of repairing connection in the steel building is even more tedious and more costly. So after this earthquake in foreign countries, they tested so many connections, at least more than 120-150 full scale connections were tested, and based on that recommendations were prepared for the further standards to be modified. And then those connections were nominated as a pre-qualified connections. That means a design engineer can directly take the details from those connections. Okay, this was just brief about the North Ridge earthquake. Now let's try to understand what is overall philosophy of section 12 from my understanding. All Indian standard codes related to earthquake engineering were earlier based on the force controlled approach. And now they have started migrating towards a displacement control approach. Let's try to understand what is displacement control approach. See, for all, generally for all buildings, we are carrying out first order elastic analysis. So when we carry out first order elastic analysis, the structure is going only under elastic displacement. Elastic displacement meaning it's a very small displacement. But during extreme event, or say extreme seismic event, structure is going to experience substantially or a significantly higher displacement than whatever we come across during elastic analysis. So by performing elastic analysis, there are two major parameters which are not available. First is the reserved strength in the structure. We don't know when we perform the elastic analysis. And the second thing, which is most important, we also do not know what is the collapse mechanism, meaning from which point the failure could be triggered in case of the seismic event. So the overall philosophy of section 12 is that steel frames shall be so designed and detailed as to give them adequate strength, stability and ductility to resist severe earthquake in all zones without collapse. That means structure will experience certain amount of damage based on the intensity of earthquake, but structure should not collapse. So this is the way I interpret section 12, which is equivalent to say IS 13920, which is for ductile detailing of RCC structures. Similarly, section 12 may be identified as a section for the ductile detailing for the steel structures. So let us take an overview of section 12. Now, section 12, as we have discussed, it is for earthquake resistant design, so it is applicable to frames which is resisting the earthquake. There are different frames introduced in section 12, like braced frames and moment frames. In braced frames also there are three types of frames which are included, which is OCBF, SCBF and EBF. And for moment frame also there are two kinds of frames. Now this is interesting. When we refer to section 4 of the code, which is IS 800/2007, it talks about three kinds of analysis. First order elastic analysis, what we are performing generally. It also talks about second order elastic analysis for certain conditions. It also talks about plastic analysis. Okay. Now when we talk little bit, let's talk quickly little bit about plastic analysis. In IS 800 or as well as in BS 5950 or static loading, plastic analysis is allowed. So by utilizing plastic analysis, in fact, we can optimize our structures to a great extent. This is a typical figure which shows that if we perform plastic analysis, then we can reduce or we can have the capacity at least 15% higher for a particular beam. Now if we talk about a complete structure, there are so many joints or so many redundancies available in the structure. So if we perform plastic analysis, then we can utilize the reserved strength of the structure. Now in entire section 12, the more thrust is given to the connection and the design forces or the capacities have been increased generally by 20%. So overall philosophy is that the connection should not fail, member should fail first. In connection details, all welding shall be complete penetration butt welds. And in bolted connection, it has to be high strength friction grip bolts. When we talk about ordinary concentrically braced frames, as we discussed that there are two or three types of braced frames introduced, it is said that the inelastic deformation corresponding to joint rotation of at least 0.02 radians without degradation in strength and stiffness below the full yield value should be achieved. Now what does it mean? It means that we have to carry out non-linear analysis to demonstrate that our structure under consideration can withstand rotation of 0.02 radians. Now, if we talk about the frames, like for special moment resisting frames, for these frames which would be in the higher seismic zone, for those frames, this value has been increased to 0.04 radians. Also, there are clauses for the bracings, like K bracing is not permitted, slender bracings are not permitted, and bracing slenderness ratio shall not exceed by 120. Now, that is the logic for the 120. Like, up till now, we are just performing elastic analysis. But if we go for, but if we perform inelastic design, then, and if our slenderness ratio is beyond 120, then we will not be able to achieve the drift requirements, what is specified in IS 1893. So that's why we have to adhere to this strict requirement of slenderness ratio. Similarly, there are guidelines given for the utilization ratio as well as for the connection design. For specially concentrically braced frame, it has been said that the all columns should be a plastic section. EBF, there are no provisions given in the code. It has been said that the specialist literature should be performed. So, if we take quick comparison with the old Indian standard code, the connection design is going to be stringent as compared to the or when we compare present and the latest code. So, connection design should be completely rechecked with respect to the latest code. So, let me put few concluding remarks here, that the buckling restraint resistant brace are becoming now very much popular in the foreign countries also. So, this may be included in our Indian standard code. Connection design is very important when we talk about earthquake resistant design. And connection design should be in scope of structural engineer and should not be in a scope of agency who is preparing the fabrication drawings. Quality of welding is very much important and very crucial for the earthquake resistant design. Generally, shock welding should be preferred wherever it is possible. Some confusions faced by structural engineer can be answered through the philosophical angle of the section 12, as we have just discussed. Performance-based design is now is coming up, and each can result into significant saving of the material, as well as we can also identify the structural deficiencies. Knowledge sharing is very much important within the group of the structural engineering for this kind of areas. And we can have interaction with BIS for the unresolved doubts and queries. We can share with them, and then we can have reach to the common conclusion also. And the last point which I want to make here, that whatever software we are using should be authenticated. Again, we should be aware about that. What are the limitations of the particular software, whatever we are using? Okay, thank you.